to this service of Christmas Eve on the night of our Lord's birth, December 24th, here at Christ Episcopal Church in Albemarle. Service begins on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you have caused this holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that we who have known the mystery of that light on earth may also enjoy him perfectly in heaven, where with you and the Holy Spirit he lives and reigns, one God in glory everlasting. Amen. We now have the lessons assigned for this glorious evening.
A reading from Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord. Join with me in saying the psalm appointed for today, Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the whole earth. Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations and his wonders among all peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is more to be feared than all gods. As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols. But it is the Lord who made the heavens. Oh, the majesty and magnificence of his presence. Oh, the power and the splendor of his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, you families of people. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth tremble before him. Tell it out among the nations, the Lord is King. He has made the world so firm that it cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful and all that is therein. Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy before the Lord when he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. A reading from Titus. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, Lord Christ. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. And this was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to their own towns to be registered, So Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver the child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find the child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with an angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." The Gospel of the Lord. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. It is amazing to me how the world seems to get a little smaller every day. It seems that there can be just a little bump in the road in a small village 12 time zones away, and people have gathered around a hillock to discuss the historical and cultural significance. And we hear on MSNBC about a great mountain far away that is affecting pork belly futures here in North Carolina. Everything is connected. As I drive most any time, I can listen to reports to the ups and downs of the stock market in London, in Singapore, in Tokyo. It's not that I particularly understand the details, but it's ominous voices indicating that the markets are down, while the cheerier ones celebrate that the market's going up. Of course, and of late, we've all been getting whiplash from following all those international and national ups and downs. When my family returned to the United States from South Africa in 1957, it took 17 days by sea. When I flew from Johannesburg to Atlanta in 2007, it took 17 hours. When my mother's father died in 1953, we were living in Dublin, and the message was sent by telegraph to my father at the embassy. For time and distance were too great for mother to return to North Carolina for her father's funeral. But when my aunt died about several years ago, I heard from a daughter, my cousin, and within hours, and then Linda and I drove back to Raleigh on the day of the funeral. I remember having a conversation with Bishop Mwamba Botswana about how time was experienced. Now, his father had been with the Zambian embassy in the United States when he was growing up, so his knowledge of our American culture is solid. He understands American time. What he said was that different cultures look at time in different ways. Here in the United States, we tend to see and experience time in linear fashion, established by specific times set by that ever-moving clock. But Bishop Mwamba went on to say that in traditional culture in Africa, time is event-related. This means that it is the event, not the clock, that determines when things happen. Its focus is on the people and the action, not on the chronologically based agenda. I have to say I found that rather refreshing, but here some would probably be frustrated by the lack of agenda with a file named date and timestamp. Our concepts, experiences of time have changed over just a couple of generations. Communication used to be by letter, then by mail, now by texting, email. Though there are contexts in which mathematical, empirical, or scientific approaches have and do serve extremely well, it is important for us to suspend sometimes our very Western, linear, chronologically based, defined sense of time, place, and story. If we look at the Christmas story with contemporary eyes, then we will experience what we experience is sort of a sweet little tale, more akin to cherubs and cute little animals talking to one another, rather than the greatest story ever told. Now let me be clear, I'm not saying that we are moved to a blind, literalistic, simplistic understanding, no, far from it. Rather, I'm suggesting that we come to understand the Christmas story in ways that demand that we see the completeness of Christmas and not get trapped in the detail. This is something like a theological version of finding a way to see the forest and not just the trees. How a story is understood and told changes our world as our world changes. We need to remember this as we hear about Jesus' birth. But if we look at the Christmas story from an analytical, dichotomous, right, wrong, black, white perspective, then we will see neither the heart nor the nuances of the telling of Jesus' birth. In reality, there is much about the story that does not make sense to us. It isn't logical with many of our contemporary processes. Remember that there's not one, but several ways we can look at issues and events and people. Remember that if we get hooked on worrying about the validity of December 25th as the date of Jesus' birth, then we're in trouble. These matters are not particularly important. There is no birth certificate. There is no parish register that broke the record that Mary had a baby boy on the 25th of December. It is probably that the 25th is 9 months after March 25th, which is the Feast of the Annunciation to Mary, one of the oldest three feasts of the Church, that she would bear a child. December 25th is also the day the Romans celebrated one of their many gods, and the early Church might well have appropriated that day. There are many responses to why the 25th, and they're all interesting. But it's not the date that is important. It's rather that the birth took place. It is the birth at the heart of the greatest story ever told. All we can do with such as this is to fuss over it like a dog on a bone. That in the greatness of the story, does it matter? No, it really doesn't. We may think of Jesus' birth story as a winter solstice event when snow is on the ground and Jack Frost is nipping at our nose. But remember that half the world were then in December at the height of winter, of summertime. It's somewhere in the mid-40s here today, well, actually, this more probably the 30s, but in Botswana, it was in the upper 90s. The Christmas story is filled with contrast and things that do not seem to make sense. The events may not make sense to us, but they are consistent with how God did and does things. Remember, our God is one who had Abraham to be the foundation of the family of God that would have more members than the stars in the sky, and he had no children. There was Moses, who killed a man and fled to his homeland, and then was sent back to be the great liberator of the people. But he had to have his brother Aaron do the talking, because Moses had difficulty speaking clearly. There was David, who had the affair with a wife on one of his generals, had Uriah set out in the front of battle so he would be killed. And then David had added Bathsheba to his harem as another of his several wives and many concubines. There is Peter the fisherman, who often got it wrong, and Paul the Pharisee, who persecuted and then proclaimed. God does not do linear time. God does not do things in ways that we would do them. God knows us and knows the ways that help us and guide us to seeing the greater rather than the smaller. Caesar Augustus, the first and perhaps the greatest of the Roman emperors, declared that there would be a census within the Roman Empire. He wanted to know what and who was part of great as the great Western Empire of his. So, all the people were to be registered. Luke is even specific enough about the time. He wrote that it was during the period that Quirinius was governor of Syria. And those Joseph and Mary traveled to Bethlehem of Judea, David's city, to be registered. And there in a stable she gave birth to a baby boy. And this newborn was wrapped up in cloths to keep him warm. He was placed in a manger, a feeding trough that animals use. How easy it is for us to see already the contrast that are being set up in the story of Jesus' birth. The great Roman Emperor Augustus versus David of the United Kingdom of Israel and Judah. The first emperor versus the first unifying king. Rome versus Bethlehem. Nobility versus craftsmen. Palaces versus stable. Temples versus a cave. Power versus vulnerability. Domination versus and control versus submission and powerlessness. An emperor, a governor, a king versus a baby, shepherds in their flock. Does any of this make sense to you? If some think tank was to develop a plan to implement a universal change of how people understand themselves, their world, and the relationship with the divine, then I don't think this is how they would do it. Take such a plan to a funding agency, they would laugh you out of the room. But God takes something or someone and turns it all around so that we are confounded and then puts it before us so that we are conceived with new eyes of faith. so that we can hear with new ears of faith, so that we can know with a new mind of faith, so that we can believe with a transformed heart of faith. One man, Jesus, through whom God became present to by the obedience and faithfulness of Mary, transformed the world. He started as we did, a small and dependent baby in need of protection, caring, loving, teaching, correcting, maturing. He grew into a young man who continued to learn, to feel, to know, to love, to protect, and to understand what it is to be fully human. And then Jesus left the safety of hearth and home to show us that one person can make a difference, that one person can show us the way back to God. Jesus showed us that asking questions can put us on the path to answers. He showed us what happens when we invite the least of the likely to speak on his behalf. These are the ones who brought Moses, their Moses and David-like faults, who let God bless these failings, who let God empower for ministry, and then become the others who transformed the world. Jesus showed us that God is not about judgment and punishment, but about grace and absolute love for all his children. He showed us how we can learn and live in a way that we care for those in need, that we welcome and seek and shelter from all storms of life. And we become the windows through whom others see God. It started with a baby. It all started when Joseph had to go to Bethlehem because some faraway emperor wanted to know who lived in his empire. It happened because the Creator invited a young woman, Mary, to be the bearer of God. It happened because of simple people heard the divine voice. Our celebrations of Christmas are to remind us of how God turned the world upside down by doing the unexpected. He came not in power and glory, but in simplicity of that most basic and natural event of humanity, birth. That one baby became a man, and he transformed the world. Our celebrations of Christmas are to remind us of how one can transform the world, how one can join with another and transform the world, how we, too, are asked to join with others and transform our world. It started in a place and time that was small and isolated, but is no longer small. In our world that is no longer small and isolated, let us see that in the smallest of events, there came the greatest of opportunities to be made whole. From one came many. Let us take our small steps to follow the infant's path and transform our world, one faithful act at a time. Amen. I invite you to join with me in saying together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and the world using Form 4. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord, hear the prayers of your people, and what we have asked faithfully grant that we may attain effectually to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, and who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit was made perfect of the man of the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. And therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. And he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. For on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, with him, and in him, the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us eat the feast. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God grant you the lightness in your step, a smile on every face you meet. Loved ones gathered at your hearth and at your door, your good friends to greet. A holy hymn upon your lips, a window candle burning bright. And may the good Lord bless your heart and come to dwell this pre-Christmas night. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.